Very warm good morning to all of you. So today we are going to discuss on this post-traumatic endophthalmitis. And mind you, this endophthalmitis is way different from the routine endophthalmitis we have been hearing and talking about since our PG days. There are a lot of things which are different in a traumatic endophthalmitis, and that is the purpose of my talk here. Number one, it comprises of majority of the endophthalmitis overall. If you see the spectrum, the majority of them are post-traumatic. Now, in an open globe injury, the traumatic, the endophthalmitis rate can be as low as 2% or 0% to as high as 40 to 50%. So that is a huge number, and you must always anticipate an endophthalmitis in a case of trauma, as Dr. Paritosh rightly said in the beginning. Now let's see what are the cases where you should suspect, because preempt is the main thing. If you preempt, you can save and do a lot of things, a lot of good to the patient. So if the patient is young, the wound looks dirty, if there's a foreign body, especially non-metallic, then there's a high chance. In fact, if there is a foreign body, any kind of foreign body, you can suspect that some inoculum has gone into the eye, and you should always think of prophylaxis. If the patient has had an injury in the rural settings, and if there is disruption of the lens capsule. Now, disruption of the lens capsule can be either, it's a double-edged sword. The fecal anaphylactic reaction can also cause a lot of reaction in the eye, and then sometimes you are in a fix whether this reaction is because of infection or is this because of endophthalmitis. And the second thing they say is that it causes a good connection between the anterior chamber and the posterior chamber, so the organisms get a good access to the posterior part. This is the zones which are very important. If it's in zone 1, which is up to the limbus, then chances of endophthalmitis is less, although an infection can still be high. Zone 2 is up to 5 millimeters, and zone 3 is beyond 5. So anything beyond zone 3 is not only bad for the eye as far as the infection is concerned, but also because there's retina starting beyond that, and it will be very bad prognosis. There are lots of bacteria and funguses, organisms which cause injury, infection into the eye. But the most prominent ones which need special mention are Staphylococcus aureus, epidermidis, bacillus, and in fungus it is candida. The bacillus is a ubiquitous organism found in the soil. So if there is any soil injury which is involving soil or mud, then you should suspect this. The characteristic thing is the rapid onset. It is a very bacillus serious, actually is actually a serious thing. So the serious is the strain which causes this bad injury. So it is characterized by this severe pain. It will worsen in just like Pseudomonas very fast. It will have hypopyon chemosis. There will be a lot of pain. There will be ring shaped infiltrates, which are actually autoimmune infiltrates. And it progresses to total corneal opacity, panophthalmitis, and no PL in very fast, in no time. Other organisms causing fulminant infections are Pseudomonas and Clostridium. Now, fungal infection you can suspect. Most common is, as I told you, is Candida. But they are usually slowly progressive, quiet eyes presenting over many days after the injury. And sometimes you might be able to see some inflammatory mass like cotton balls in the vitreous cavity. Another important thing is reactive endophthalmitis. Now, all those, if you remember the table we used to study in our schooling days, the Fe coni, that is iron, copper, and nickel, they are ferromagnetic things, and they cause reactive endophthalmitis. They cause reaction. Especially pure copper and pure iron can cause a lot of reaction. So this reactive endophthalmitis can be because of this ferromagnetic foreign bodies, also because of cortical matter, as I just said. But unless it is proven otherwise, you should take this all these things as endophthalmitis and treat them as infectious endophthalmitis. What are the features which will tell us that this is going into endophthalmitis? If the prepare has not been done, if the patient says the pain is out of proportion of the degree of injury, this is one characteristic sign that there will be more pain than what it seems like, you know. And the visual acuity is far worse than what you expect. There's purulent exudation, there's hypopyon, vitritis, retinitis. Sometimes there can be, you know, just a mild periphlebitis in the periphery, or some vitreous infiltration and some exudation along the vessels. Even that small tiny sign, especially in cases of fungal and this quiet organisms like epidermidis, staph epidermidis, they are very helpful in saving the eye. If the repair has been done, then if there is increase in pain, there is reduction in vision, there is hypopyon, vitritis, and all those things, you should suspect endophthalmitis. Now, the management, as I already has been discussed, is systemic evaluation is very, very important. You should not forget about the life of the patient, and not just only focus on the eye, but also see the adnexa and the orbit. that we tend to forget. And we suspect a foreign body always, suspect a posterior segment in injury always, because even the blunt trauma can cause a retinal detachment in so many cases. So in these cases, you should always suspect a bad prognosis, explain that to the patient. Then you should think of imaging the patient. Patch the eye if you're sending the patient for imaging. Sometimes we tend to forget that in the heat of the moment, and the patient is also panicked, we send the patient, and even the B scan is being done without care being taken. The B scan should always be done with a closed lids and in a very gentle way so that you don't cause any further trauma. So cause no harm to the patient is very important. And if you are in a non-tertiary center and you're working in a periphery, if you feel that patient has a foreign body, there's no harm in repairing the patient. Do not send the patient, especially if it has to travel for long distances, do not send the patient without the primary repair. And another good different thing which differentiates this endophthalmitis from a routine post-op endophthalmitis is the prophylaxis. So, we're talking about prophylaxis intracameral. In my practice, I always give intracameral, this thing, if it's an inter-segment injury, and with a post-segment injury, I'll give a prophylactic antibiotic. Because the one simple reason is that this type of endophthalmitis is different. The organisms are very serious. The damage is very fast. You don't have time. So, it's better to inject than to feel sorry later on. And another important thing is that antibiotics in traumatic endophthalmitis does not mean topical antibiotics. So prophylaxis does not mean topical antibiotic. Prophylaxis means systemic antibiotics and sometimes IV antibiotics too. IV means intravenous. So it can be topical, intravitreal, and systemic and intravenous also, depending on the severity. But not all infections lead to endophthalmitis. So it's like we should not send all the patients for culture. Suppose you're seeing a patient which is very fairly clear patient. I can see suppose a small tiny foreign body was there in the cornea or iris penetrating injury. I have removed it from the iris and I see it's quite clear. Especially this high projectile foreign bodies are inert because of the heat they have when they come into the eye. So there was a study done showed that the patient did show some organisms when they were cultured, but not all of them developed endophthalmitis. So we need not send a routine culture sensitivity in all the patients of traumatic endophthalmitis, but we can always do the prophylaxis. Tetanus is very important. There's no harm in giving extra TT also. A CT scan is done. We have a foreign body, and then you have to do a CT scan. It has to be a 1 millimeter or 0.5 millimeter cuts and with coronal reconstruction images. For non-metallic things, the soft tissue window is very important. If you don't have a foreign body, then just doing a B scan and X-ray, a digital X-ray should suffice, and we don't need to send the patient, all the patients for of traumatic injury for a CT scan. In case of both ceramic and plastic, you have to do an MRI, but then metallic foreign body has to be absolutely ruled out, and the patient also should not be on any kind of pacemakers and any metallic implants. X-ray detects only 40% of the foreign bodies. Now, doing a B scan should be done, as I told you, very, very gently through closed lids. What we can suspect and see in this case is vitreous opacification, which can be either vitreous hemorrhage or it can be endophthalmitis. Now, a serial B scan is also kind of prognosticating. You can do a B scan every day to see whether the vitreous infiltration is worsening or is getting better. So, B scan can also be prognosticative, and you can help you in management also. It is not just for one-time thing. It can tell you about the foreign body, tell you about the retina status, the vitreous posterior highlight status. For a surgeon, if the posterior highlight is detached, then it becomes an easy job for the surgeon to do the surgery. Now, the US Eye Injury Registry says that the wound should be closed as early as possible. Cortical lens cleanup is very, very important, but the IL usually is not sent, not put. Antifungal and prophylaxis usually is not done in absence of viral fungal signs and vegetative injury. Now, the treatment consists of vitreous tap and biopsy, intravitreal injection, systemic antibiotics, and vitrectomy. Now, taking the vitreous tap is not an easy thing, especially in young patients, because most of these patient trauma patients are young patients. You can either do a needle aspiration, but it's better to do a vitreous biopsy with a cutter. Number one, it yields more sample. Number two, it causes less traction. The positivity increases when you do a vitreous tap. And if you're not able to take a vitreous tap, it is not a bad idea to even, if you're not even able to get even a sample with the needle aspiration, you can just send the needle in that blood agar plate and just send it for culture. And if in desperation you can all when nothing is obtained, you can send a AquaStep also, although the chances of getting a positive yield from AquaStep is less. This I think we already know, we can skip it. Another important thing is to send a PCR. If you're not getting in the first step, you're not getting anything and the patient is worsening, the second thing is to will be to send a PCR sample. The yield of microbiological positivity goes high from 46.5% to 75.8%. Another important, as I think, which I told earlier, is the systemic antibiotics. In no other endophthalmitis, this is so important as it is in traumatic endophthalmitis. The systemic antibiotics are very important. The EVS study had some flaws also. The antibiotics covered were not actually covering the spectrum of organisms. They had mostly gram-positive covered, gram-negative was not covered. They did not study the traumatic endophthalmitis. So the EVS things cannot be extrapolated to traumatic endophthalmitis. Also, the penetration is very good and antibiotic penetration becomes better when the eye is inflamed. So, the good thing is that despite so many organisms involved in this traumatic endophthalmitis and serious organisms like Bacillus cereus, the antibiotics which work systemically are fairly basically just two, most of them, mostly. It works on most of them. Number one is vancomycin and number two, ceftazidime. Clindamycin can be used for anaerobic precipitates and in cases where the vancomycin is contraindicated. Now, third generation cephalosporins are good for gram-positive, but mind you, for Pseudomonas, the second generation ciprofloxacin still holds good. And Genta and Amica do not reach the MIC level in the eye, so systemically it might not work well, but in intravitreal injections it can be given. For antifungal, again, the systemic penetration is not good of all the antifungals, including amphotericin. It causes also nephrotoxicity. So better is to give some voriconazole or ketoconazole tablets and then give intravitreal antifungal injections and topical natamycin and voriconazole. So the important thing is that this condition is very grievous and we have to give systemic and topical antibiotics. And primary repair is very, very important. One should do imaging with care. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Ashish.